Hello friends, welcome to daily editorial enrichment program brought by Law Excellence R&D team. Today we will discuss important articles that has been appeared in the newspaper The Hindu dated 27th November 2019. Now moving on to the first article. It reads, the misadventure of a new citizenship regime. The rationale for a nationwide register of citizens, its feasibility and above all its moral legitimacy are questionable. This is subheading. This topic can be related to the syllabus GS2, that is government policies and interventions for development in various sectors and issues arising out of their design and implementation. From prelims and mains perspective, we have to cover on particulars of NRC and issues associated with it. Now let us look into what is NRC, that is National Register of Citizens. The NRC is the list of Indian citizens and was prepared in 1951, following the census of 1951. The process of NRC update was taken up in Assam as per Supreme Court order in 2013. This process of NRC was taken up in Assam in order to wean out cases of illegal migration from Bangladesh and other adjoining areas. NRC updation was carried out under the Citizenship Act 1955 and according to the rules framed in Assam Accord. Now let us look into why it is being carried out in our country. First thing is crisis of identity. Influx of immigrants has created a crisis of identity among the indigenous people. Locals fear that their cultural survival will be affected, political control will be weakened, and employment opportunities will get undermined because of immigrants. And the next thing is environmental degradation. Large areas of forest land were encroached upon by the immigrants for settlement and cultivation. So this will put pressure on the state's forest cover. Then to address the financial burden. Immigration has increased the pressure on the part of state government, as the government has to increase the expenditure on education and health facilities to the immigrants. And then to weed out the illegal voters. For example, most of the Bangladeshi immigrants in Assam have got their names enlisted in the voting list illegally. Coming back to the newspaper editorial now. Here, the author says that the hunger of the Indian state for counting its citizen, that is counting its people, is always unsatisfactory. Now, the Office of the Register General and Census Commissioner has completed a 10-year project of data collection for the census of 2021. Along with this, the individual level data collection for the National Population Register, that is NPR, is also in place and they are going to upload it in next summer. And also, nearly 123 crore Aadhaar cards have been also issued. With all these exercises, yet another exercise in counting was proposed, that is for a nationwide National Register of Citizens in the Parliament. Before, NPR and census were counting residents rather than citizens. But now the objective of this latest initiative, that is NRC, is to count citizens, specifically to sort the citizens from non-citizens, to include or to exclude, and also to weed out infiltrators from the foreign countries. Talking about NRC, here the author raises the issues regarding the cost of authentication, that is, resources needed to conduct such NRCs over the nation. Now, in Assam, the NRC was conducted and it is reported to have costed 1600 crore with 50,000 official deployed to enroll almost 3.3 crore applicants. Now, if you are going to conduct the NRC for nationwide, that is for the Indian electorate of 87.9 crore people, then nationwide NRC would require an outlay of 4.26 lakh crore rupees. Now, here the author says that which is more than the double the presumptive loss in the 2G scam and 4 times the budgetary outlay for education this year. Conducting NRC nationwide involves huge cost and also the deployment of many officials. Along with this, there are many uncertainties too with respect to the cutoff date, because assigning 1948 July as the cutoff date is not practical in light of constitutional provisions and also the enactment of the Citizenship Act in 1955. And the second uncertainty is that will enrollment in the NRC be compulsory or voluntary? And also the author raises the question that what might the consequences of not seeking registration in the NRC? In the final analysis of this article, the author notes that there is a transformative shift from civic national conception to an ethno-national conception of India. And the author says this because there is an explicit promise of citizenship in the Citizenship Amendment Bill 2019 to the migrants who belong to specified religious groups, all except Muslims, in three nations. And then author says that the cutoff dates and the resource constraints are only cautionary arguments against this potential misadventure. and then the author argues for the citizenship based on birth and without regard to creed that our constitution guarantees. Now, moving on to the next article, that is not so Swachh. Sanitation cannot be a separate ideal without reference to other forms of deprivation. That's the subheading. This article can be related to the syllabus GS1, that is population and associated issues, poverty and developmental issues, urbanization, their problems and their remedies. And also to the syllabus GS2, government policies and interventions for development in various sectors and issues arising out of the design and implementation. And from the prelims point of view, we have to cover Swachh Bharat Mission and then NSO. And from the mains point of view, we have to cover significance and performance of Swachh Bharat Mission, shortcomings and ways to address them. Now let us have a quick revision on NSO survey findings. The latest NSO survey on sanitation showed that about 71% of rural households had access to toilets as against the government's claim of 95%. And significant gaps have been found between government claims and NSO survey. That is, in Karnataka there is a gap of 30%, Madhya Pradesh 29%, Andhra Pradesh 22% and Maharashtra 22%. And 42% of the rural households in Jharkhand had no access to toilet. Gujarat declared ODF in 2017. However, according to NSO, almost a quarter of all rural households had no access to toilets. Coming back to the newspaper article, Swachh Bharat Mission was launched in October 2014. And it is the world's largest sanitation program, and it has changed the behavior of hundreds of millions of people with respect to toilet access and also usage. And in economic survey also, in 2018 economic survey, it depicts the exponential growth in sanitation coverage for the same. And also there is an impressive increase in access of toilets. The government claims 9.2 crore toilets have been built in rural areas. Based on toilet construction, the government has declared 28 states and union territories as open and defecation free. But independent survey shows that open defecation continues even in areas that the government has declared open defecation free. High levels of coercion have been used to build the toilets and behavioral change has been slow to follow. And also, access to toilet doesn't mean open defecation has ended, as the government claims. Here, in this article, the author says that the data from the NSO could help in reviewing the performance of the states such as Jharkhand, Tamil Nadu and Rajasthan, where the lack of toilets is reported to be higher than the national average. And more fundamentally, he says, the survey provides an opportunity to review other social determinants such as education, housing and water supply, which have a strong influence on adoption of sanitation. Come back to way forward now. The first thing is, we have to bring the all-round development in rural areas, that is fast-paced economic growth. And also there are two key ingredients in order to bring the toilet access to all, that is rural housing and then the water supply. And also we have to concentrate on capacity building and resource management. Along with this, we must continue our sustained work, and also there must be a massive urban program which are critical to ending the open defecation and universalizing the toilet access. What are the key factors to be considered for critical ending of open defecation? The first thing is educating people about hygiene and the social marketing of toilets. And government should also focus on creating a demand for toilets. Policymakers must make sure that higher proportion of funds are directed towards educating the people here. Then resolving the issue of over and under reporting. To resolve the issue of over and under reporting of government set targets, verification of facts on the ground is highly important. And then proper disposal. That is, proper facilities for the disposal of excreta should be established. Then technologies. Different cost effective technologies must be adopted for sewage treatment and proper disposal of waste from toilets. Use of technology can play a crucial role in eradicating the practice of manual scavenging. Now, moving on to the next article that reads, The Many Faces of Pak, Punjab's Militancy. This topic can be related to the syllabus GS3, that is security challenges and their management in border areas and the linkages of organized crime with terrorism. From prelims point of view, it is important to cover on country reports on terrorism, and then from mains point of view, we have to study on cross-border terrorism. Country Reports on Terrorism is an annual report published by United States Department of State. In 2005, it replaced the patterns of Global Terrorism Report, which had been released since 1985. What is cross-border terrorism? The term cross-border implies a movement or an activity across the border between the two countries. Cross-border terrorism is a gray zone conflict. It is an undeclared war and considered to be highest form of strategy to bleed a nation for the long time, for the long periods, by small efforts. And this terrorist activity is defined in Prevention of Terrorism Act 2002, that it defines terrorist activity as one which intends to threaten the unity, integrity, security or sovereignty of India or strike terror in the minds of the people. And then cross-border terrorism includes unconventional tactics like cyber attacks, political warfare, perception war, etc. And the factors which support this cross-border terrorism are, first one is porous border, that is India's borders with most of the neighbor countries are porous, that is not protected, which are extremely easy to cross, easy to access. And then comes the support from non-state actors, that is Pakistan facilitates movement of its proxies across the border with the only motive of creating terror in India. And then there is internal support. Sometimes the local population support the terrorism and facilitate cross-border movement of terrorists by providing them the safe places to hide. Then corrupt officials. These corrupt officials will allow illegal migrants whose identities and backgrounds are unknown. And then these channels will provide the scope to criminal elements to cross over to mainland India. Now, coming back to newspaper article. The US Congress has released country reports on terrorism, and which has clearly mentioned that Pakistan has failed to significantly limit the Punjab-based militant outfits like Lashkar-e-Taiba and Jaish-e-Mohammed. Over the years, most of the Pakistani militants have crossed the border and they were caught by Indian security personnel also. And the one element here, common thing, is they were all from the Punjab province. Extremities recorded in these regions are Pakistani military supported. We have to note that Punjab overshadows other provinces in Pakistan primarily due to its size, resources and representation in elite institutions. Here in this article, the author says that there are two things that have supported the cross-border terrorism. That is, one is migration and the other one is water scarcity. And the British author Ian Talbot also written that the 5 million migrants from the Indian side of the border have both provided a major support for Islamist parties and shaped the Punjab province's strong anti-India and pro-Kashmiri leanings. And adding to this, another issue used by militants to gain support is that of seasonal water scarcity. Whenever there is a seasonal water scarcity, terrorist outfits such as Lashkar-e-Taiba points finger at India. And Jihad in Kashmir is presented as a necessity by organizations like JUD to save Punjab's agriculture. The other reasons for militancy is that political marginalization. The Southern Punjab had stated that political marginalization, weak governance, economic neglect and also inequality are the main reasons for which it supports militancy in Southern Punjab. Another reason for militancy is that there is also a role played by economically poor Muslim migrants from India in the spread of a radical version, that is Deobandi school of Islam. And now moving to the way forward and what can be done to curb the terrorism. First thing is there is a need to reassess our policies on number of issues pertaining to the management of India's international borders, such as intelligence apparatus, internal security and border management. Then, technical solutions are necessary to augment and complement the traditional methods of border guarding. These technical solutions not only enhance the surveillance and detection capabilities of the border guarding forces, but also improve the impact of the border guarding personnel against infiltration and trans-border crimes. Then, India should move in the direction of specialization of military to fight cross-border terrorism. Now, moving on to the next article, it reads Negotiating the Fault Lines. It is with respect to Me Too movement. This topic can be related to the syllabus GS1, that is issues relating to women. From prelims and mains perspective, we have to study on significance of Me Too movement and then importance and its concerns and then need of better mechanisms to deal with sexual harassment cases. About Me Too movement. It is initially developed in the West in 2017 and then Me Too movement has spread in almost all the major parts of the world. And the second wave of the movement has been experienced in the countries like India and Korea. Me Too is a global campaign against sexual harassment and also the assault, where women from all over the world open up and share their experiences, stories, throwing light on sexual abuse. And the common hashtag Me Too aims at exposing the scale of sexual assault, and also this movement has bound together various forms of sexual assaults. It is imperative in this backdrop to understand the legal resources in place to sexual harassment at the workplace. So let us understand what are Vishakha guidelines. The Vishakha guidelines were laid down by the Supreme Court in Vishakha and others versus State of Rajasthan judgment in 1997. It imposes three key obligations on employing institutions, that is prohibition, prevention and redress. The institutions are mandated to establish a complaints committee, and this was to look into matters of sexual harassment of women at workplace. These guidelines are legally binding. Now let us see what are the key provisions in the Sexual Harassment of Women at Workplace Prevention, Prohibition and Redressal Act 2013. Firstly, it broadens the Vishakha guidelines which were already in place. Then it gives the definition, that is, an aggrieved victim is a woman of any age, whether employed or not, who alleges to have been subjected to any act of sexual harassment. Thus, this act covers the rights of all women working or visiting any workplace in any capacity. Sexual harassment is any one or more of unwelcome acts or behavior committed directly or by implication. They include physical contact and advances, a demand or request for sexual favors, sexually colored remarks, showing pornography, and any other unwelcome physical, verbal or non-verbal conduct of sexual nature. Under this act, every employer must constitute an internal complaints committee at each office or branch with 10 or more employees. And this complaint has to be made within 3 months from the date of the incident. For a series of incidents, it has to be made within 3 months from the date of the last incident. However, this time frame is not rigid, as the ICC can extend the time limit, and in case of any false complaint and false evidence, ICC may recommend the employer to take action against the woman who has made the complaint. Coming back to the newspaper article again, here the author says that when a movement is based on the premise that a woman must be believed simply because she is a woman, then it carries a seed of self-destruction. And we have seen in the past few days that there are few series of tweets against men regarding the sexual harassment. And at the same time, we have also come across fake incidents also. Because of these fake incidents and fake allegations, it became evident that not all women had been entirely honest when jumping into Me Too movement. Now, moving on to way forward. Me Too movement rewrote the rules of engagement, that it forced the men to take the idea of consent seriously. Then it pushed the organizations to sit up and take notices of sexual harassment. And then also it ensured that due process mechanisms were set up in the institutions. Finally, the conclusion. First thing is, we have to boost the ethical and moral education. Then we have to conduct workplace auditing, that it should be made compulsory in the organizations having more than 10 workers, including male and female workers. Then time-bound redressal mechanisms, that laws must be made to protect the sexual harassment should be based on speedy trial and conviction principle. Then conducting awareness programs. Any organization having female and male workers should organize seminars and conferences to sensitize the workplace atmosphere. Finally, the penalty for false allegations. Equally, there should be a penalty mechanism to deter the false allegations made by the woman. Thank you for watching.